can have it anytime, all the time, because that's our right. It sounds weird, because we're not used to that kind of talk. Everything is scarce. We've been immersed and dumped into a world of scarcity, and this shining little glimmer of hope that maybe one day I can get to the top of the pile and I can be in charge and I can rule and I can have more than everybody else. Well, that's the problem. Competition is the problem. Competition is the odd thing out. Competition goes against the law of nature. Competition is nothing but a con. Unity is what we need, not competition. Unity. We don't need money. Money is the hurdle to all progress. Not anywhere in here did you see the word money. We need all these things, and we should have all these things, but we don't need money. That's the lie that we've been told. Money does nothing, after all, people. People do things. People plow the lands. People create the food. People solve the mathematical solutions and build the bridges and the rockets and the computers. It's people that create arts and culture, not money. Money is the hurdle to all progress, an obstacle to absolute abundance on all level. Money also prevents a natural flow of free energy. You saw in those video clips that I showed you, a guy with a burning salt water. Money is the hurdle to all progress. He probably tried to sell that kind of information and technology. Peter Davy waited until he died to sell the technology with boiling water or sound, and eventually died, and now it's, I don't know what's happened to that technology. Money is the primary cause of the seven deadly sins. Am I boring you yet?
No.
There you go. What happens when you take money out of the system? Because it's not the love of money, it's the mere presence of money. And some people argue that, oh, it's just the love of money. There's nothing wrong with money. Money is just a form of exchange, of energies. No. You're completely misguided, brother, when you say that. It's the mere presence of money that creates these problems. And any form of money, any form of exchange that can be argued as money, or a different kind of money, or time control, or time banking, or barter, or trade, anything that can be argued as any form of money is the problem. That's the problem. So what do we do if money is the problem?
Get rid of it.
Remove money.
It's only consciousness, not money. Consciousness is the problem. And the consciousness, our awareness, is the only thing that will change it. Because everything we have reflects our consciousness.
You're absolutely right.
So we can't hate money, we can't hate power, we can't hate the bad guys or the good guys. We need to love them.
You're absolutely right. We can't hate anything. We need to embrace it, and we need to change it. I call it contributionism, where everybody contributes their natural talents or their acquired skills for the greater benefit of all in their community. It's nothing new. It's what all ancient cultures have been practicing. It's a completely new social structure because it does not embrace money. It removes it and moves away from it and goes back to the natural order of things and abundance for all. And this brings us back to Africa, where it all started, and where it seems that it's going to explode from again, or reignite from again. Because it might come as a surprise that the Hopi chiefs in 1982 went down to South Africa and met with the elders of Africa, like Kreda Mutwa and others, to discuss of the rise of the new age from South Africa. The Hopi people and many others believe that the new age will rise out of South Africa, not just Southern Africa, but South Africa. And they came to discuss this in 1982 already, and this is the time that they were talking about. Kreda Mutwa confirmed this when I saw him last year. So many ancient cultures believe if it's not good for everyone, it's no good at all. And that's really the fundamental basic principle for contributionism, or as the Africans called it, Ubuntu. A world without money, there's no crime, no envy, no gluttony, no greed, no hoarding, no hierarchy, no obstacle to any kind of progress. In contributionism, you can solve any problem. Just repeat this mantra for yourselves, this five-pointed mantra. No money, no barter, no trade, no value attached to anything. It's greater or lesser than anything else, because each one of us is equally and infinitely valuable, and so is our contribution. If you don't believe that yet, then you need some more guidance. Where everybody contributes for the greater benefit of all in their community. As I said, it's not utopia, it's the natural order of things. And it's a self-correcting system. That's what I found. After 7 years of study and introspection and looking at it from every possible way, every possible angle, how is this going to work in a moneyless society? How is that going to work? How is prostitution going to work in a moneyless society? You've got to think about everything. And it's, you get some really interesting answers when you start looking at this. Just repeat this five-pointed mantra. And within a few minutes, you will find the answers yourself. It's a complete paradigm shift, turning everything you think of in life today on its head. Some people do it with ease, others struggle with it. And then the obvious questions come. You know, who's going to shovel the crap? I'll just sit on my ass and do nothing. If everything is free, I'll want 50 Ferraris. And how are we going to pay for things? And are we going back to the dark ages? Is this a lawless society? Who makes the rules? All these things are so simply answered and resolved if you just think about them for a little while. And most of these will be available on my website, on the Ubuntu website, and many more of these questions, because these are just the first questions I bet many of you were thinking. All about united communities and unity consciousness. As you said, it's all about consciousness. How we see ourselves in this large world and in this greater universe, and how we interact with each other. It's a world of absolute abundance, everything available to everyone at all times. And there are certain rules and regulations, if I can use those words, that will be designed and devised by the communities within their levels of consciousness, that you'll see as you approach this from that headspace, from that mindset, how beautiful and how simple it is. So that children can follow their passions and be taught by master teachers and not go through draconian schooling systems to come out with some certificate that is absolutely useless. Because that's unfortunately what has happened. Our education system is just a preparation for the marching soldiers to march to the beat of the drum.
That's right.
Of the monetary society and the capitalistic society we find ourselves in. So this is really what it comes down to. Only out of unity comes infinite diversity and infinite abundance. And it's on this note that I want to say thank you very much for coming, because it's taken us full cycle from the origins back to where we're going. We're crossing the galactic plane. We got to wake up, unite in consciousness, and start acting as a united species. Otherwise, we're going to die like flies. And I believe it's this system that is probably very close to what nature has offered us. Money is just, well, it was just a temporary distraction, and we had to go through that to realize it was actually a tool to help us to high levels of enlightenment, awakening, and consciousness. Now, to take this further, we're launching in South Africa the Ubuntu Party in September this year. Not because we want to go into politics, I want to go into politics, but some of the philosophies we're going to share with everybody are so radical that it could be seen as terrorist activity. Yeah.
It is.
You're going to be undermining the welfare of the state. So it's a platform of protection. So read up more about the Ubuntu Party and contributionism on ubuntuparty.org.za. And thank you very much for coming. If there are any questions, you've got a question?
Yes, I was wondering, in the millions of circular structures that you have have you ever done any excavation going down? What's beneath them?
Yeah. Unfortunately not. There have been excavations done by others. I haven't done so myself. But they go down and they find that they go down a few meters, sometimes only just 1 meter or 1.5 meters. And then they reach the same conclusions. They found in one or two of them people being buried inside them at about 1.5 meters deep. And then they automatically ascribe that ruin to those people being buried there. So, oh, they must have built it because they were buried here. Whoa! Interesting leap, right? and then that goes into the history books and the textbooks, and that's what the children have to learn. And if they can't regurgitate it, they fall and they're no good to society, right? Yes. No, the government has not recognized Adam's calendar as an ancient site. It's still just a pile of rocks, unfortunately. That's what it is.
Can you briefly tell us what's going on with the
briefly what's going on
yeah,
with Max.
With
yes.
your case, with your case.
With my case, I really chose to use my particular situation to highlight the deception of the banks, and I pretty much put everything I have on the line, which looks quite shaky at the moment because they have all the power, as you know. And I was in the Supreme Court in South Africa 3 times arguing myself. I didn't have lawyers or advocates arguing on my behalf. And by the 3rd time I got in there, I got some help from a lawyer who is an advisor for the South African military and police for 20 years, who came as an absolute godsend and an angel. And even though we had more than 30 legal points where the banks break the acts, break the law, break the bills, spelled out in our presentation. It was like talking to the wall. It's about the judge wasn't even in the same room. And even when the advocate of the bank stood up and very red and red in his face, very angry, top of his voice, started arguing against me, saying, oh, I'm causing trouble and they're sick and tired of me. And I said, oh, really? What has that got to do with any of this? It was actually quite funny. You know, we were calm and collected, but then he agreed, even when he spoke, he admitted to all the things that I've accused the bank of. So everyone in the courtroom was waiting for the judge to turn around and say, well, that's really interesting. You just admitted you make money out of nothing, that you create money through debits and credit entries, that you're actually not acting as a bank, that you're actually acting as an intermediary, as an agent, and you shouldn't be able to charge any interest on this stuff. The fact that you don't have any locus standi because you securitize all these mortgages and these loans, so you've lost locus standi or any rights to the properties. All these arguments we had, and the fact that you broke contract law because you didn't have what you said you were going to lend, they were basic legal arguments. The judge just looked at him and said, thank you very much. Now, have you got anything else to say, Mr. Tellinger? And I stood up, I said, yeah, he just admitted to everything we were arguing. And the judge said, oh, thank you very much. Now I'm going to read you my judgment.
Verdict.
He pulled a piece of paper in front of him and read the judgment.
Yep.
Like that. It was like that. He pulled a piece of paper in front of him. It was pre-written.
Yeah. Michael, I got from your website, the way it started was you had a mortgage, you wanted to pay off, and you were going to the bank and asked to see the documents. And
yeah,
they gave it
to you. That's right. I asked them for the basic documents, my original promissory note, and I asked them for an official statement. They didn't even want to give me a statement. At the point that I started asking for that, I didn't have a statement for almost a year. So I thought, you know, let me just use the situation. And I started writing them notarized affidavits. They didn't answer any of my notarized affidavits. And that didn't hold up any water in South Africa. A judge didn't even look at that. Not once did he question the bank about the fact that they didn't respond to my notarized affidavits. It's just, it's a complete circus in there. It's unbelievable. And then when we lost for the 3rd time, with all these legal arguments, we thought, okay, we're going to take it to the Constitutional Court and declare it unconstitutional, which we then did. And we wrote a 1,100-page paper that we submitted to the South African Constitutional Court, which was accepted, given a case number, and we made a big hoo-ha about that. And by the time, their time was up, and they had to submit their answering affidavits. Standard Bank had not yet submitted their affidavit, only the Reserve Bank, because we basically sued the Minister of Finance, because he's supposed to deal with this, it's his jurisdiction, his responsibility to protect the people, and he knew about the illegality of their actions. So the Minister of Finance, the South African Reserve Bank, because they control all the banks, or they work with the banks with the money that they create, and then the Standard Bank themselves, which is, as you know, the oldest and the biggest bank in Africa, and any company with the word standard in it must be linked to the Rockefellers somehow.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Just a little hint. So we submitted that, and only the Reserve Bank had submitted their arguing affidavit. It was 7 pages long, people. 7 pages against 1,100 pages. We looked at this, we went, okay, hold on. Something strange is happening here. A week later, Standard Bank had not yet filed their answering affidavit, and the Constitutional Court called us in, and they told us, sorry, we're throwing this out. No prospect of success, without even hearing the answering affidavit. That's how constitutional the South African Constitutional Court is, that Nelson Mandela was so proud of opening and launching. It is a complete shambles, and we're supposed to have the most advanced Bill of Rights and Constitution in the whole world. That's great to have it, but if you can't use it, what's the purpose? So the idea now is that we're going to go back and we're going to launch new, submit new documents to through a different process where we got two judges and a third judge in a kind of a trial situation. Remember, all the time through this whole process, all I ever wanted out of this is to go to a fair trial where we can call in witnesses. That's all I wanted out of it. I didn't want the bank to pay me anything or give me anything. All I wanted was to be given a fair trial that I was denied all the way through. So now we're going to try and force the issue of a fair trial through another kind of approach through, I don't quite understand it, but I'll find out more about it when I get home. And let's see what happens. That's where it sits right now. But at this stage, it's possible that I might be losing a lot of stuff, including a house and other stuff. I hope it doesn't happen. I believe it doesn't happen. At one stage, I tell you, in the last appearance in the Supreme Court, the day before I went into the Supreme Court, I got an email from Standard Bank offering me, shows you the left hand doesn't know, they get all these collection agencies that they appoint, right? So they send me an email saying, we are giving you a final offer to sell your house and then write off the shortfall on a tax-free, over 10 years tax-free. So I printed that out and I used that in court and I brought that up as an argument. I said, look, this is an email, an offer I got from Standard Bank yesterday. And here they are arguing against me, so I reserve the right to take them up on this offer if all things go against me. So that's still on record, that it wasn't denied, it wasn't argued against, it was accepted into court, so it's on record. So I'm going to exercise that right if things really fall apart to take them up on their offer to sell my house and write off the tax-free over a 10-year period, the shortfall on the property. So that's where it stands right now, people. So it's an interesting journey, but it's all for a reason, because I think all this experience is going to play a really important role in the credibility of the Ubuntu Party when we launch that. So when we start telling people the truth, it comes from a place of personal experience and not just hearsay. Mm-hmm. So all these things are divinely guided. That's how I believe it to be. But now it's been a long night. Sorry, David.
One last question, Michael. What is more for the average person here that's heard?
So it's more for the average person here that's heard this information, some people for the first time, other people that might be aware of certain aspects. What can each individual person do now that they're at least on the trail of this? And what can we do in terms of, we don't quite have communities working together quite yet, but what can we do on an individual level right now just to start things moving on?
I think the most important thing you can do is talk to other people about it. Just share this information with other people. Because if they haven't heard about it, they need to hear about it at some stage. And remember that once you've heard it, you can't unhear it. And it's really important. So I normally finish these presentations by saying, go out and tell everyone. Tell everyone what you know. Whether they're ready for it or not, it doesn't matter. Because remember, it works the other way. You get all these evangelists, all these people trying to sell you their stuff, right?
Can I just say something about the Bank of Canada?
Yeah.
For those people who haven't heard Victoria Grant, she's a 12-year-old girl. She explains how the Bank of Canada works. And I would suggest that people do go to the Council of Canadians. They have a position statement on that we should actually use the Bank of Canada to lend money to ourselves and get the economy going the way that we want to without interest. Because the Bank of Canada belongs to all Canadians. And they took that right away in 1975. From after the war until 1975, the Bank of Canada actually did have loans to itself without interest. So I really encourage people to explore what the Bank of Canada is and what we can do with it.
Well, thank you so much for coming. Thanks for listening. Tell your friends. Thank you.